Thanks for making it today. Bhooshan, as you said, we're going to present an ECA rules engine for IoT applications using Cask data application platform, which is a flagship product here at Cask. So a little bit about the use case to start off with. Three major components in ECA. First one is event parsing and managing schemas and rules. And on these rules, you have conditions. Conditions are Boolean expressions that determine whether a certain decision needs to be taken. And then the ability to actually to make those actions signal notification that decision itself. And that is based on the result of the conditions. So this has been a fairly common paradigm in classical, complex event processing, event-driven architectures. But it's slightly new to the Hadoop world, to the more scale-out world. So we're presenting a way of achieving that without having to go into the intricacies of achieving it. So a few use cases where this could apply. Typical IoT scenarios, smart home applications where you have home security systems, you could have appliance monitoring, smart appliances that send signals to infer decisions about the state of those devices, whether they need maintenance, etc. The other common application is for wearables, elderly care, monitoring your vital stats, hitting your fitness goals, monitoring your workouts, and so on. Any typical IoT application. If you look into the characteristics of all these use cases, data arrives in continuous real-time data streams. Every event could potentially have a different schema. And then there is some amount of metadata management where you could register schemas, you could register rules for a schema, etc. But the essential takeaway being there's no one constant schema to ops. And that sort of adds to the complexity of subsystems. So a little bit about the Cask data application platform. It's a unified integration platform. Basically, its job is to act as a middleware layer between Apache Hadoop and all the systems in that encompasses, and your applications on top, applications that actually run your business logic. So abstractions could include things for ingesting data, for storage, for compute, both batch and real time. For ingress, putting data out of your system, as well as blocking visual pipelines. And so, if you focus on the middle layer here, it's the layer that ties together preparation, cleansing of data with data integration, discovery, data science. But along with all of that, gives you certain platform features that are essential to put something into a production ready scenario where business can depend on it, where revenue can depend on it, and there is a certain amount of guarantees. Some of these characteristics are metadata management, security, governance, lineage tracking, provenance, etc. The idea is to not have to build all of these things every single time you create an application, but for a platform middleware provide these for you on out of the box. And then imagine a scenario where, because the higher layers use the middleware layer, the layers at the bottom can potentially be swiped out for other systems as long as the platform itself supports them. So that's how the Cask data application platform is sort of thought about. To achieve ECA, there are other things that that were built using components of the Cask application platform. So one of the first components of ECA that we saw in the first slide was metadata management, which will include schemas and rules for those schemas. So there's a custom CDAP application that provides RESTful APIs and a UI for managing schemas and rules for those schemas. You can add a schema, specify unique fields in the schema, and then based on those unique fields, there is a rules repository that determines the kind of conditions that need to be applied and then actions as a result of those conditions. You also need, for data processing itself, a real-time high-throughput ingestion endpoint. And one of the abstractions that CDAP provides is CDAP stream, which is built over HTTP and is high-throughput streaming ingestion. You could alternatively also use Apache Kafka for the same use case. We have chosen CDAP stream because we're going to use Apache Kafka for a different use case in the same demo. CDAP also provides one of the more newer features in CDAP is data preparation directives. These are simple data transformation directives that can help based on a schema transform it, cleanse it, munge it, but also generate measurements from the schema. We'll talk about measurements in the next couple of slides. And then you have the pipeline itself, where it's a real-time pipeline based off of Spark streaming. And it is basically composed of two major plugins, a generic event parser plugin that can parse events using a schema repository, and then a rule executor plugin that uses a rules repository to apply rules that are applicable to the inferred schemas. So some ECA concepts, we've gone through some of these, but some more details. Events are typically data from sensors, from wearable devices, from appliances, any IoT devices. They could be generated at edge by aggregators, for example. Schema defines what fields are in the event, the type of those fields, and some rules and transformations that need to be applied on it in order to make it useful during data processing. Measurements are quantitative measures. They could apply on a field in the schema and infer additional value. We have a measurement in the demo, and I will make it even clearer. Conditions are Boolean expressions that can be applied on an event, and then the application supports complex conditions like using logical operators. And then actions are decisions like we've already spoken about, and there would be send someone an SMS dad's heart rate has increased beyond a certain point, or things like that. And then a schema hash is a unique identifier for a schema, and it can help to look up transformations and rules that apply on a given event. So the typical ECA architecture, you have either wearable devices or appliances or even aggregators that can run on edge nodes, and then they produce events in real time, which are consumed either using CDAP streams or Apache Kafka. And then the pipeline has two plugins. One is an event parser that determines the kind of event, its schema, the fields in it, etc. And then it decides what kind of transformations need to be applied on it. It reuses a schema registry, which is a repository of schemas that are managed by the ECA app that I spoke about earlier. The app exposes REST APIs to update, basically perform product operations on schemas. The next plugin in the pipeline is a rules executor. The rules executor reads the output of the event parser and determines the rules that need to be applied on incoming events. It also uses a repository called the rules registry, which is a CDAP dataset. And then you have a management interface over that repository as well. And ultimately, the result of executing rules are actions that can be used to generate notifications based on how the result evaluated. And then you could have a reliable notification dispatcher. What this would do in a typical scenario was if your actions were submitted to or published to a messaging queue, say Apache Kafka, some topic on Kafka, a reliable notification dispatcher would subscribe to that topic and then take the action, send someone an SMS and send someone an email if that condition is satisfied. So a little bit about that schema and rules management flow. So there are two components. You either add a schema, or for a given schema, you manage rules, add rules, remove some rules, etc. So to add a schema, you provide basic info such as names, unique fields in the schema, and then a collection of transformations that determines some cleansing, preparation, transformation that needs to be applied on an event that conforms to the schema. And then that's stored in the schema repository. You can also specify rules for a schema, and those go into the rules repository. When you typically add, so the distinction between device type and device over here is a device type would be a Fitbit. A device could be your Fitbit that has a particular IBM number, etc. So to add a new device, you would check if its schema is available. For my Fitbit, if Fitbit is already registered, its schema is available. But then I may want to add some tools for my own Fitbit as well. And that's the schema. I'm not going to go into any details about the architecture. We already sort of covered all of these things in that diagram. So a typical event process was a a typical telemetry event, in this case it's JSON, could be anything. You have complex fields inside it. One of the first transformations that you could apply on it is to flatten it so as to generate a top level of unique fields in that event. Based on the hash of those unique fields, you determine the transformation that you need to apply. These transformations could just be cleansing, preparation, etc. type of transformations, but they could also generate measurements. So, for example, in this case, you have calories before and you have some sort of a notion of time or a bunch of steps, and a measurement that was generated was calories per step. And this got added as an extra sort of field in your schema, and that will be processed in the rules. So for this unique schema, the rules repository had a certain set of rules that were being considered. For example, if the battery of the device is greater than 885, and then there's an SOS alert, send an SMS to some pre-configured user of Google. And you know, calories per step is greater than 10, send an email to some. These rules are then executed by the rules executor, and an output is generated in the form of the actual event itself, and then the actions that hold true for the product event. This could typically be posted to some asynchronous messaging service from where the live notification dispatcher could consume those events and you know, take the appropriate action. So let's look at how this works. So I have a schema management UI here. I have two types of devices. One is an iWatch, the other I'm going to enter now. So it's a Fitbit heart rate schema. And then the unique fields in the schema are heart rate, some device ID, name of a person, and a timestamp. And then my only transformation in this case is going to rename the field device to be called key. And this fits into the logic of my processing pipeline. We'll talk about how that works. We added a schema. So there's two schemas here. One is for a Fitbit, the other is for an iWatch. There's some unique fields in each of those in events emitted from those devices. And then there are transformations that apply on the different schemas. The logic in my processing pipeline is it depends on a field key, which is an identifier. And in these two cases, I am deriving the key from the device name. But imagine a situation where you could derive that key from a combination of various fields or any other single field in that schema. There is also the rules for schemas. So if you look at for the iWatch, I have a rule that says if calories per minute is less than 10, I send an SMS to someone. I also have another rule. The key is FP Blaze, and I'm adding two rules. One that says notify me if the heart rate is either less than 50 or greater than 100. Then I add that rule, and then I can go back to my pipeline. But before that, let me show you the sample data that I have. This data conforms to those two schemas that we added. This is the schema of the FB Blaze that we added, and this guy is the iWatch. And the keys for the rules, like I said, were generated from the field device. if you look at the pipeline, this is the pipeline that I described before. This is a CDAP data streams pipeline, which can be built using a visual drag and drop interface. And the input for this pipeline is a CDAP stream, which allows you to specify the name, the format, the schema of events that are generated out of it, etc. Then there are two plugins that we spoke about, the event parser, which will read the schema repository that we manage over here, and the rules executor that will read the rules repository and execute rules. After that, I sort of have two folks in the pipeline, one that two branches in the pipeline, rather, one that handles events for which SMS needs to be generated, and the other that handle emails. And then they are sent to two queues. These are Apache Kafka syncs, and one writes to the topic SMS, the other writes to the topic email. So what we'll do is add some more sample data into this pipeline. So I'm uploading the same data that I showed you to that input stream to add some events. And then the pipeline should start processing them. This is based off of batches part streaming, so and it executes in micro batches, and the batch interval is a minute, so it might take some time to execute. We can come back, we can show you that those events start showing up over here and here. So in my data, for a device of type FB Blaze, my rules were if the heart rate is greater than 100 or below 50, I think I sent an email. So that's what I received over here. And the other one, sorry, that was the SMS one. The other one was if the calories per minute, which is here, it's less than 10, you send an SMS as well. So that shows up over here. And then this is the Kafka console consumer that ships with Kafka, but imagine that you could have potentially a listener process for this that actually does the job of sending the email or the SMS. So that was the demo. You can see processed that data that we sent in. Switching back. So to summarize, there's a schema and rules management component of this, which we saw through that UI, allows you to perform CRUD operations on schemas and rules. And then there is a real-time streaming pipeline that uses spark streaming, reads from a stream, parses the events, generates a hash for that unique event based on the field setup, and then applies pre-configured rules for that schema, and then publishes messages to do a bunch of the queues. So that was basically it. Open to questions. Sure.
Do you have any inheritance on the rules?
The inheritance of the rules, yes. So remember the flow that I had shown where there was a device type and a device itself? And that could be built in using those directives. I didn't want to get into too much of a complex scenario for the demo itself. But yes, you could apply inheritance based on, for example, what a person's particular device is, versus loss type kind of property. If there are no rules for my own device supply, the rules that apply to all devices of the type. Anything else? That's all. Thank you so much.